The Portuguese, Os Lusiadas. By Luís Vaz de Camoies. Podcast 2 of 10. Book 2. The Argument. Arrival of the expedition at Mombas. Bacchus plots their destruction by new artifices. They are deceived into the belief that the natives are, like themselves, Christians. Bacchus assumes the character of a priest, and worships the god of the Christians. At the invitation of the king of Mombas, Gama enters the port, and reaches the place intended for his destruction. Venus, aided by the Nereids, effects their deliverance, and Gama sails away, fearing treachery. Venus hastens to Olympus to seek Jove's aid. Jupiter assures her of the future glory of the Portuguese, and commands Mercury to conduct the expedition to Melinda. The king of Melinda asks from Gama an historical account of his nation. End of the argument. Commence. The fervent luster of the evening ray. Behind the western hills now died away. And night, ascending from the dim-browed east. The twilight gloom with deeper shades increased. When Gama heard the creaking of the oar. And marked the white waves lengthening from the shore. In many a skiff the eager natives came. Their semblance friendship, but deceit their aim. And now by Gama's anchored ships they ride. And hail, illustrious chief! Their leader cried. Your fame already these our regions own. How your bold prows from worlds to us unknown. Have robbed the horrors of the southern main. Where storms and darkness hold their endless reign. Whose whelmy waves our westward prows have barred. From oldest times, and ne'er before were deared. By boldest leader, earnest to behold. The wondrous hero of a toil so bold. To you the sovereign of these islands sends. The holy vows of peace, and hails you friends. If friendship you accept, what are kind heaven. In various bounty to these shores has given. What are your wants shall here supply. And safe in port your gallant fleet shall lie. Safe from the dangers of the faithless tide. And sudden bursting storms, by you untried. Yours every bounty of the fertile shore. Till balmy rest your wearied strength restore. Or, if your toils and ardent hopes demand. The various treasures of the Indian strand. The fragrant cinnamon, the glowing clove. And all the riches of the spicy grove. Or drugs of power the fever's rage to bound. And give soft languor to the smarting wound. Or, if the splendour of the diamond's rays, the sapphire's azure, or the ruby's blaze, invite your sails to search the eastern world. Here may these sails in happy hour be furled. For here the splendid treasures of the mine, and richest offspring of the field combine, to give each boon that human want requires, and every gem that lofty pride desires. Then here, a potent king your generous friend, here let your perilous toils and wandering searches end. He said, brave Gama smiles with heart sincere. And prays the herald to the king to bear. The thanks of grateful joy, but now, he cries. The blackening evening veils the coast and skies. And through these rocks unknown forbids to steer. Yet, when the streaks of milky dawn appear. Edging the eastern wave with silver hoar. My ready prows shall gladly point to shore. Assert of friendship, and a kind retreat. Assert and proffered by a king so great. Yet, mindful still of what his hopes had cheered. That here his nation's holy shrines were reared. He asks, if certain, as the pilot told. Messiah's lore had flourished there of old. And flourished still. The herald marked with joy. The pious wish, and, watchful to decoy. Messiah here, he cries, has altars more than all the various shrines of other lore. O erjoyed, brave Vasco heard the pleasing tale. Yet feared that fraud its viper sting might veil. Beneath the glitter of a show so fair. He half believes the tale, and arms against the snare. With Gama sailed a bold advent-rous band. Whose headlong rage had urged the guilty hand. Stern justice for their crimes had asked their blood. And pale, in chains condemned to death, they stood. But, saved by Gama from the shameful death, the bread of peace had sealed their plighted faith. The desolate coast, when ordered, to explore and dare each danger of the hostile shore. From this bold band he chose the subtlest two, the port, the city, and its strength to view, to mark if fraud its secret head betrayed, or if the rites of heaven were there displayed. With costly gifts, as of their truth secure, the pledge that Gama deemed their faith was pure. These two, his heralds, to the king he sends. The faithless Moors depart as smiling friends. Now, through the wave they cut their foamy way, their cheerful songs resounding through the bay. And now, on shore the wandering natives greet, and fondly hail the strangers from the fleet. The prince their gifts with friendly vows receives, and joyful welcome to the Lusians gives. Where'er they pass, the joyful tumult bends, and through the town the glad applause attends. But he whose cheeks with youth immortal shone, the god whose wondrous birth two mothers own, whose rage had still the wandering fleet annoyed, now in the town his guileful rage employed. A Christian priest he seemed, a sumptuous shrine he reared, and tended with the rites divine. O'er the fair altar waved the cross on high, upheld by angels leaning from the sky, descending o'er the Virgin's sacred head. So white, so pure, the Holy Spirit spread the dove-like pictured wings, so pure, so white, and, hovering o'er the chosen 12, alight the tongues of hallowed fire, amazed, oppressed, with sacred awe their troubled looks confessed the inspiring Godhead, and the prophet's glow, which gave each language from their lips to flow, where thus the guileful power his magic wrought. Dagama's heralds by the guides are brought, on bended knees low to the earth they fall, and to the Lord of Heaven in transport call, while the feigned priest awakes the censer's fire, and clouds of incense round the shrine aspire. With cheerful welcome, here caressed, they stay, till bright Aurora, messenger of day, walked forth, and now the sun's resplendent rays, yet half emerging o'er the waters, blaze. When to the fleet the Moorish oars again dash the curled waves, and waft the guileful train, the lofty decks they mount, with joy elate, their friendly welcome at the palace gate, the king's sincerity, the people's care, and treasures of the coast the spies declare. Nor past untold what most their joys inspired, what most to hear the valiant chief desired, that their glad eyes had seen the rites divine, their country's worship, and the sacred shrine. The pleasing tale the joyful Gama hears. Dark fraud no more his generous bosom fears. As friends sincere, himself sincere, he gives the hand of welcome, and the Moors receives. And now, as conscious of the destined prey, the faithless race, with smiles and gestures gay, their skiffs forsaking, Gama's ships ascend, and deep to strike the treacherous blow attend. On shore the truthless monarch arms his bands, and for the fleet's approach impatient stands, that, soon as anchored in the port they rode, brave Gama's decks might reek with Lusian blood, thus weaning to revenge Mozambique's fate, and give full surfeit to the Moorish hate. And now their bowsprits bending to the bay, the joyful crew the pond rouse anchors way, their shouts the while resounding to the gale. With eager hands they spread the foremast sail, but love's fair queen the secret fraud beheld, swift as an arrow o'er the battlefield. From heaven she darted to the watery plain, and called the seaborn nymphs, a lovely train. From Nereus sprung, the ready nymphs obey, proud of her kindred birth, and own her sway. She tells what ruin threats her favorite race. Unwonted ardour glows on every face. With keen rapidity they bound away, dashed by their silver limbs, the billows gray. Foam round, fair Dodo, furred with rage divine, darts through the wave, and onward o'er the brine. The lovely Nyse and Nerine spring, with all the vehemence and speed of wing. The curving billows to their breasts divide, and give a yielding passage through the tide. With furious speed the goddess rushed before. Her beauteous form a joyful triton bore, whose eager face with glowing rapture furred, betrayed the pride which such a task inspired. And now arrived, where to the whistling wind, the warlike navy's bending masts reclined. As through the billows rushed the speedy prows, the nymphs dividing, each her station chose. Against the leader's prow, her lovely breast, with more than mortal force the goddess pressed. The ship recoiling trembles on the tide. The nymphs, in help, pour round on every side. From the dread bar the threatened keels to save. The ship bounds up, half lifted from the wave. And, trembling, hovers o'er the watery grave. As when alarmed, to save the hoarded grain, the caverns store for winter's dreary rain. So toil, so tug, so pant, the lab-ring emmet train. So toiled the nymphs, and strained their panting force, to turn the navy from its fatal course. Back, back the ship recedes, in vain the crew. With shouts on shouts their various toils renew. In vain each nerve, each nautic art they strain. And the rough wind distends the sail in vain. Enraged, the sailors see their labors crossed. From side to side the reeling helm is tossed. High on the poop the skillful master stands. Sudden he shrieks aloud, and spreads his hands. A lurking rock its dreadful rifts betrays. And right before the prow its ridge displays. Loud shrieks of horror from the yardarms rise. And a dire general yell invades the skies. The Moors start, fear-struck, at the horrid sound. As if the rage of combat roared around. Pale are their lips, each look in wild amaze. The horror of detected guilt betrays. Pierced by the glance of Gama's awful eyes. The conscious pilot quits the helm and flies. From the high deck he plunges in the brine. His mates their safety to the waves consign. Dashed by their plunging falls on every side. Foams and boils up around the rolling tide. Thus the hoarse tenants of the Sylvan Lake. A Lycian race of old, to flight betake. At every sound they dread Latona's hate. And doubled vengeance of their former fate. All sudden plunging leave the margin green. And but their heads above the pool are seen. So plunged the Moors, when, horrid to behold, from the barred rock's dread jaws the billows rolled. Opening in instant fate the fleet to whelm. When ready Vasco caught the staggering helm. Swift as his lofty voice resounds aloud. The pond rouse anchors dash the whitening flood. And round his vessel, nodding o'er the tide. His other ships, bound by their anchors, ride. And now revolving in his piercing thought. These various scenes with hidden import fraught. The boastful pilot's self-accusing flight. The former treason of the Moorish spite. How headlong to the rock the furious wind. The boiling current, and their art commend. Yet, though the groaning blast the canvas swelled. Some wondrous cause, unknown, their speed withheld. Amazed, with hands high-raised, and sparkling eyes. A miracle! The raptured Gama cries. A miracle! O hail, thou sacred sign! Thou pledge illustrious of the care divine! Ah! Fraudful malice! How shall wisdom's care escape the poison of thy gilded snare? The front of honesty, the saintly show, the smile of friendship, and the holy vow. All conjoined are easy faith to gain. To whelm us, shipwrecked, in the ruthless main. But where our prudence no deceit could spy. There, heavenly guardian, there thy watchful eye. Beheld our danger, still, O still prevent. Where human foresight fails, the dire intent. The lurking treason of the smiling foe. And let our toils, our days of lengthening woe. Our weary wanderings end. If still for thee. To spread thy rights, our toils and vows agree. On India's strand thy sacred shrines to rear. O let some friendly land of rest appear. If for thine honor we these toils have dared. These toils let India's long-sought shore reward. So spoke the chief, the pious accents move. The gentle bosom of celestial love. The beauteous queen to heaven now darts away. In vain the weeping nymphs implore her stay. Behind her now the morning star she leaves. And the sixth heaven her lovely form receives. Her radiant eyes such living splendors cast. The sparkling stars were brightened as she passed. The frozen pole with sudden streamlets flowed. And, as the burning zone, with fervour glowed. And now confessed before the throne of Jove. In all her charms appears the queen of love. Flushed by the ardour of her rapid flight. Through fields of ether and the realms of light. Bright as the blushes of the roseate morn. New blooming tints her glowing cheeks adorn. And all that pride of beauteous grace she wore. As when in Ida's bower she stood of yore. When every charm and every hope of joy. Enraptured and allured the Trojan boy. Ah! Had that hunter, whose unhappy fate. The human visage lost by Dion's hate. Had he beheld this fairer goddess move. Not hounds had slain him, but the fires of love. Adown her neck, more white than virgin snow. Of softest hue the golden tresses flow. Her heaving breasts of purer, softer white. Than snow hills glistening in the moon's pale light. Except where covered by the sash, were bare. And love, unseen, smiled soft, and panted there. Nor less the zone the god's fond zeal employs. The zone awakes the flames of secret joys. As ivy tendrils round her limbs divine. Their spreading arms the young desires entwine. Below her waist, and quivering on the gale. Of thinnest texture flows the silken veil. Ah, where the lucid curtain dimly shows. With doubled fires the roving fancy glows. The hand of modesty the foldings threw. Nor all concealed, nor all was given to view. Yet her deep grief her lovely face betrays. Though on her cheek the soft smile fault ring plays. All heaven was moved as when some damsel coy. Hurt by the rudeness of the amorous boy. Offended chides and smiles, with angry mien. Thus mixed with smiles, advanced the plaintive queen. And thus, O thunderer! O potent sire! Shall I in vain thy kind regard require? Alas! And cherish still the fond deceit. That yet on me thy kindest smiles await. Ah heaven! And must that valor which I love. Awake the vengeance and the rage of Jove? Yet moved with pity for my favorite race. I speak, though frowning on thine awful face. I mark the tenor of the dread decree. That to thy wrath consigns my sons and me. Yes. Let stern Bacchus bless thy partial care. His be the triumph, and be mine despair. The bold advent rouse sons of Tagos climb. I loved alas. That love is now their crime. O happy they, and prosperous gales their fate. Had I pursued them with relentless hate. Yes. Let my woeful sighs in vain implore. Yes. Let them perish on some barbarous shore. For I have loved them. Hear the swelling sigh. And pearly tear drop rushing in her eye. As morning dew hangs trembling on the rose. Though fond to speak, her further speech oppose. Her lips, then moving, as the pause of woe. Were now to give the voice of grief to flow. When kindled by those charms, whose woes might move. And melt the prowling tiger's rage to love. The thundering god her weeping sorrows eyed. And sudden threw his awful state aside. With that mild look which stills the driving storm. When black rolled clouds the face of heaven deform. With that mild visage and benignant mien. Which to the sky restores the blue serene. Her snowy neck and glowing cheek he pressed. And wiped her tears, and clasped her to his breast. Yet she, still sighing, dropped the trickling tear. As the chid nursling, moved with pride and fear. Still sighs and moans, though fondled and caressed. Till thus great Jove the fates decrees confessed. O thou, my daughter, still beloved as fair. Vain are thy fears, thy heroes claim my care. No power of God's could ear my heart incline. Like one fond smile, one powerful tear of thine. Wide o'er the eastern shores shalt thou behold thy flags far streaming, and thy thunders rolled. Where nobler triumphs shall thy nation crown than those of Roman or of Greek renown. If by mine aid the sapient Greek could brave Thogygian seas, nor sink a deathless slave. If through Th Illyrian shelves Antenor bore till safe he landed on Timavus' shore. If, by his fate, the pious Trojan led safe through Charybdis' barking whirlpools sped. Shall thy bold heroes, by my care disclaimed, be left to perish, who, to worlds unnamed, by vaunting Rome, pursue their dauntless way? No soon shalt thou with ravished eyes survey from stream to stream their lofty cities spread, and their proud turrets rear the warlike head. The stern-browed Turk shall bend the suppliant knee, and Indian monarchs, now secure and free, beneath thy potent monarch's yoke shall bend, and thy just laws wide o'er the east extend. Thy chief, who now in error's circling maze for India's shore through shelves and tempests strays, that chief shalt thou behold, with lordly pride, o'er Neptune's trembling realm triumphant ride. O wondrous fate! When not a breathing gale shall curl the billows, or distend the sail, the waves shall boil and tremble, awed with dread, and own the terror o'er their empire spread. That hostile coast, with various streams supplied, whose treach rouse suns the fountain's gifts denied, that coast shalt thou behold his port supply, where oft thy weary fleets in rest shall lie. Each shore which weeped for him the snares of death, to him these shores shall pledge their offered faith. To him their haughty lords shall lowly bend and yield him tribute for the name of friend. The Red Sea wave shall darken in the shade of thy broad sails, in frequent pomp displayed. Thine eyes shall see the golden Ormus shore, twice thine, twice conquered, while the furious Moor, amazed, shall view his arrows backward driven, showered on his legions by the hand of heaven. Though twice assailed by many a vengeful band, unconquered still shall Dio's ramparts stand. Such prowess there shall raise the Lusian name, that Mars shall tremble for his blighted fame. There shall the Moors, blaspheming, sink in death, and curse their prophet with their parting breath. Where Goa's warlike ramparts frown on high, pleased shalt thou see thy Lusian banners fly. The pagan tribes in chains shall crowd her gate, while the sublime shall tower in regal state. The fatal scourge, the dread of all who dare against thy sons to plan the future war. Though few thy troops who Conan hour sustain, the foe, though number rouse, shall assault in vain. Great Calicut, for potent hosts renowned, by Lisbon's sons assailed shall strew the ground. What floods on floods of vengeful hosts shall wage on Cochin's walls their swift repeated rage. In vain, a Lusian hero shall oppose his dauntless bosom and disperse the foes. As high swelled waves, that thundered to the shock, disperse in feeble streamlets from the rock. When blackening broad and far o'er Actium's tide, Augustus' fleets the slave of love defied. When that fallen warrior to the combat led the bravest troops in Bactrian Scythia bred with Asian legions, and, his shameful bane, the Egyptian queen, attendant in the train. Though Mars ragged high, and all his fury poured, till with the storm the boiling surges roared, yet shall thine eyes more dreadful scenes behold. On burning surges rolled the sheets of fire far billowing o'er the brine, while I my thunder to thy sons resign. Thus many a sea shall blaze, and many a shore resound the horror of the combat's roar, while thy bold prows triumphant ride along by trembling China to the isles unsung by ancient bard, by ancient chief unknown, till ocean's utmost shore thy bondage own. Thus from the Ganges to the Gadian strand. From the most northern wave to southmost land. That land decreed to bear the injured name. Of Magalhães, the Lusian pride and shame. From all that vast, though crowned with heroes old. Who with the gods were demigods enrolled. From all that vast no equal heroes shine. To match in arms, O lovely daughter, thine. So spake the awful ruler of the skies. And Maya's son swift at his mandate flies. His charge, from treason, and Mombasa's king. The weary fleet in friendly port to bring. And, while in sleep the brave Dagama lay. To warn, and fare the shore of rest display. Fleet through the yielding air Selenius glides. As to the light the nimble air divides. The mystic helmet on his head he wore. And in his hand the fatal rod he bore. That rod of power to wake the silent dead. Or o'er the lids of care soft slumbers shed. And now, attended by the herald fame. To fair Melinda's gate, concealed, he came. And soon loud rumor echoed through the town. How from the western world, from waves unknown. A noble band had reached the Ethiop shore. Through seas and dangers never dared before. The godlike, dread attempt their wonder fires. Their generous wonder fond regard inspires. And all the city glows their aid to give. To view the heroes, and their wants relieve. T'was now the solemn hour when midnight reigns. And dimly twinkling o'er the ethereal plains. The starry host, by gloomy silence led. O'er earth and sea a glimmering paleness shed. When to the fleet, which hemmed with dangers lay. The silver-winged Selenius darts away. Each care was now in soft oblivion steeped. The watch alone accustomed vigils kept. Iangama, wearied by the day's alarms. Forgets his cares, reclined in slumber's arms. Scarce had he closed his careful eyes in rest. When Maya's son in vision stood confessed. And fly, he cried, O Lusitanian, fly. Here guile and treason every nerve apply. An impious king for thee the toil prepares. An impious people weaves a thousand snares. O fly these shores, unfurl the gathered sail. Lo, heaven, thy guide, commands the rising gale. Hark, loud it rustles, see, the gentle tide. Invites thy prows, the winds thy lingering chide. Here such dire welcome is for thee prepared. As Diomed's unhappy stranger's shard. His hapless guests at silent midnight bled. On their torn limbs his snorting coursers fed. O fly, or here with stranger's blood imbrued. Bizarrous altars thou shalt find renewed. Amidst his slaughtered guests his altars stood. Obscene with gore, and barked with human blood. Then thou, beloved of heaven, my counsel hear. Right by the coast thine onward journey steer. Till where the sun of noon no shade begets. But day with night in equal tenor sets. Asov reign there, of Genrau's faith unstained. With ancient bounty, and with joy unfeigned. Your glad arrival on his shore shall greet. And soothe with every care your weary fleet. And when again for India's golden strand. Before the prosperous gale your sails expand. A skillful pilot oft in danger tried. Of heart sincere, shall prove your faithful guide. Thus Hermes spoke, and as his flight he takes. Melting in ambient air, Dagama wakes. Chilled with amaze he stood, when through the night. With sudden ray appeared the bursting light. The winds loud whizzing through the cordage sight. Spread, spread the sail. The raptured Vasco cried. Aloft, aloft, this the gale of heaven. By heaven our guide, th auspicious sign is given. Mine eyes beheld the messenger divine. O fly, he cried, and give the favoring sign. Here treason lurks. Swift as the captain spake. The mariners spring bounding to the deck. And now, with shouts far echoing o'er the sea. Proud of their strength the pond rouse anchors way. When heaven again its guardian care displayed. Above the wave rose many a Moorish head. Concealed by night they gently swam along. and with their weapons sawed the cables strong, that by the swelling currents whirled and tossed, the navy's wrecks might strew the rocky coast. But now discovered, every nerve they ply, and dive, and swift as frightened vermin fly. Now through the silver waves that curling rose, and gently murmured round the sloping prows, the gallant fleet before the steady wind sweeps on, and leaves long foamy tracks behind. While as they sail the joyful crew relate their wondrous safety from impending fate. And every bosom feels how sweet the joy when, dangers past, the grateful tongue employ. The sun had now his annual journey run, and blazing forth another course begun. When smoothly gliding o'er the hoary tide, two sloops afar the watchful master spied. Their Moorish make the seaman's art displayed. Here Gama weens to force the pilot's aid. One, base with fear, to certain shipwreck flew. The keel dashed on the shore, escaped the crew. The other bravely trusts the general's foe, and yields, ere slaughter struck the lifted blow. Ere Vulcan's thunders bellowed. Yet again. The captain's prudence and his wish were vain. No pilot here his wandering course to guide. No lip to tell where rolls the Indian tide. The voyage calm, or perilous, or afar. Beneath what heaven, or which the guiding star. Yet this they told, that by the neighboring bay, a potent monarch reigned, whose pious sway, for truth and noblest bounty far renowned, still with the stranger's grateful praise was crowned. O'erjoyed, brave Gama heard the tale, which sealed the sacred truth that Maya's son revealed, and bids the pilot, warned by heaven his guide, for fair Melinda turn the helm aside. 'Twas now the jovial season, when the morn from Taurus flames, when Amalthea's horn o'er hill and dale the rose-crowned flora pours, and scatters corn and wine, and fruits, and flowers. Right to the port their course the fleet pursued, and the glad dawn that sacred day renewed, when, with the spoils of vanquished death adorned, to heaven the victor of the tomb returned. And soon Melinda's shore the sailors spy, from every mast the purple streamers fly. Rich figured tapestry now supplies the sail. The gold and scarlet tremble in the gale. The standard broad its brilliant hues berays, and floating on the wind wide billowing plays. Shrill through the air the quivering trumpet sounds, and the rough drum the rousing march rebounds. As thus, regardful of the sacred day, the festive navy cut the watery way. Melinda suns the shore in thousands crowd, and, offering joyful welcome, shout aloud. And truth the voice inspired, unawed by fear, with warlike pomp adorned, himself sincere. Now in the port the general's Gama rides. His stately vessels range their pitchy sides. Around their chief, the bowsprits nod the head, and the barbed anchors gripe the harbor's bed. Straight to the king, as friends to general's friends, a captive Moor the valiant Gama sends. The Lusian fame, the king already knew. What gulfs unknown the fleet had labored through. What shelves, what tempests dared. His liberal mind exalts the captain's manly trust to find, with that ennobling worth, whose fond employ befriends the brave, the monarch owns his joy. And greets the leader and his weary band, to taste the dews of sweet repose on land, and all the riches of his cultured fields. Obedient to the nod of Gama yields. His care, meanwhile, their present want attends. And various fowl, and various fruits he sends. The oxen low, the fleecy lambkins bleat. And rural sounds are echoed through the fleet. His gifts with joy the valiant chief receives. And gifts in turn, confirming friendship, gives. Here the proud scarlet darts its ardent rays. And here the purple and the orange blaze. O'er these profuse the branching coral spread. The coral wondrous in its watery bed. Soft there it creeps, in curving branches thrown. In air it hardens to a precious stone. With these a herald, on whose melting tongue the copious rhetoric of Arabia hung. He sends his wants and purpose to reveal, and holy vows of lasting peace to seal. The monarch sits amid his splendid bands. Before the regal throne the herald stands. And thus, as eloquence his lips inspired, O King, he cries, for sacred truth admired, ordained by heaven to bend the stubborn knees of haughtiest nations to thy just decrees. Feared as thou art, yet sent by heaven to prove that empire's strength results from public love. To thee, O King, for friendly aid we come. Nor lawless robbers o'er the deep we roam. No lust of gold could e'er our breasts inflame to scatter fire and slaughter where we came. Nor sword, nor spear our harmless hands employ to seize the careless, or the weak destroy. At our most potent monarch's dread command, we spread the sail from lordly Europe's strand. Through seas unknown, through gulfs untried before, we force our journey to the Indian shore. Alas, what rancor fires the human breast? By what stern tribes are Afric's shores possessed? How many a while they tried, how many a snare? Not wisdom saved us, 'twas the heaven's own care. Not harbors only, e'en the barren sands. A place of rest denied our weary bands. From us, alas, what harm could prudence fear? From us so few, their number rouse friends so near. While thus, from shore to cruel shore long driven, to thee conducted by a guide from heaven, we come, O monarch, of thy truth assured, of hospitable rites by heaven secured. Such rites as old Alcinous' palace cracked, when lorn Ulysses sat his favored guest. Nor deem, O King, that cold suspicion taints our valiant leader, or his wish prevents. Great is our monarch, and his dread command to our brave captain interdicts the land, till Indian earth he tread. What nobler cause than loyal faith can wake thy fond applause? O thou, who knowest the ever-pressing weight of kingly office, and the cares of state. And here, ye conscious heavens, if gum is hard, forget thy kindness, or from truth depart. The sacred light shall perish from the sun, and rivers to the sea shall cease to run. He spoke, a murmur of applause succeeds, and each with wonder owned the valorous deeds of that bold race, whose flowing veins had waved beneath so many a sky, so many an ocean braved. Nor less the king their loyal faith reveres, and Lisboa's lord in awful state appears, whose least command on farthest shores obeyed, his sovereign grandeur to the world displayed. Elate with joy, uprose the royal Moor, and smiling thus, O welcome to my shore. If yet in you the fear of treason dwell, far from your thoughts th ungen rouse fear expel. Still with the brave will honor find, an equal ardour will their friendship bind. But those who spurned you, men alone in show, rude as the bestial herd, no worth they know. Such dwell not here, and since your laws require obedience strict, I yield my fond desire. Though much I wished your chief to grace my board, fair be his duty to his sovereign lord. Yet when the morn walks forth with dewy feet, my barge shall waft me to the warlike fleet. There shall my longing eyes the heroes view, and holy vows the mutual peace renew. What from the blust ring winds and lengthening tide your ships have suffered, shall be here supplied. Arms and provisions I myself will send, and, great of skill, a pilot shall attend. So spoke the king, and now, with purpled ray beneath the shining wave the god of day, retiring, left the evening shades to spread, and to the fleet the joyful herald sped. To find such friends each breast with rapture glows, the feast is kindled, and the goblet flows. The trembling comet's imitated rays bound to the skies, and trail a sparkling blaze. The vaulting bombs awake their sleeping fire, and, like the cyclops' bolts, to heaven aspire. The bombardiers their roaring engines ply. And earth and ocean thunder to the sky. The trump and fife's shrill clarion far around. The glorious music of the fight resound. Nor less the joy Melinda's sons display. The sulfur bursts in many an ardent ray. And to the heaven ascends, in whizzing gyres. And ocean flames with artificial fires. In festive war the sea and land engage. And echoing shouts confess the joyful rage. So passed the night, and now, with silvery ray. The star of morning ushers in the day. The shadows fly before the roseate hours. And the chill dew hangs glittering on the flowers. The pruning hook or humble spade to wield. The cheerful labrayer hastens to the field. When to the fleet, with many a sounding oar. The monarch sails, the natives crowd the shore. Their various robes in one bright splendour join. The purple blazes, and the gold stripes shine. Nor as stern warriors with the quivering lance. Or moon-arched bow, Melinda's sons advance. Green boughs of palm with joyful hands they wave. An omen of the mead that crowns the brave. Fair was the show the royal barge displayed. With many a flag of glistening silk arrayed. Whose various hues, as waving through the bay. Return the lustre of the rising day. And, onward as they came, in sovereign state. The mighty king amid his princes sat. His robes the pomp of eastern splendour show. A proud tiara decks his lordly brow. The various tissue shines in every fold. The silken lustre and the rays of gold. His purple mantle boasts the dye of Tyre. And in the sunbeam glows with living fire. A golden chain, the skillful artist's pride. Hung from his neck, and glittering by his side. The dagger's hilt of star-bright diamond shone. The girding baldric burns with precious stone. And precious stone in studs of gold enchased. The shaggy velvet of his buskins cracked. Wide o'er his head, of various silks inlaid. A fair umbrella cast a grateful shade. A band of menials, bending o'er the prow. Of horn wreathed round the crooked trumpets blow. And each attendant barge aloud rebounds. A barbarous discord of rejoicing sounds. With equal pomp the captain leaves the fleet. Melinda's monarch on the tide to greet. His barge nods on amidst a splendid train. Himself adorned in all the pride of Spain. With fair embroidery shone his armed breast. Four polished steel supplied the warrior's vest. His sleeves, beneath, were silk of poly blue. Above, more loose, the purple's brightest hue. Hung as a scarf in equal gatherings rolled. With golden buttons and with loops of gold. Bright in the sun the polished radiance burns. And the dimmed eyeball from the luster turns. Of crimson satin, dazzling to behold. His cassock swelled in many a curving fold. The make was Gallic, but the lively bloom. Confessed the labor of Venetia's loom. Gold was his sword, and warlike trousers lacked. With thongs of gold his manly legs embracked. With graceful mien his cap aslant was turned. The velvet cap a nodding plume adorned. His noble aspect, and the purple's ray. Amidst his train the gallant chief beray. The various vestments of the warrior train. Like flowers of various colors on the plain. Attract the pleased beholder's wandering eye. And with the splendour of the rainbow V. Now Gama's bands the quivering trumpet blow. Thick o'er the wave the crowding barges row. The Moorish flags the curling waters sweep. The Lusian mortars thunder o'er the deep. Again the fiery roar heaven's concave tears. The Moors astonished stop their wounded ears. Again loud thunders rattle o'er the bay. And clouds of smoke wide rolling blot the day. The captain's barge the general's king ascends. His arms the chief enfold, the captain bends. A reverence to the sceptred grandeur due. In silent awe the monarch's wandering view. Is fixed on Vasco's noble mien, the while. His thoughts with wonder weigh the hero's toil. Esteem and friendship with his wonder rise. And free to Gama all his kingdom lies. Though never son of Lusus race before. Had met his eye, or trod Melinda's shore. to him familiar was the mighty name. And much his talk extols the Lusian fame. How through the vast of Afric's wildest bound, their deathless feats in gallant arms resound. When that fair land where Hesper's offspring reigned, their valor's prize the Lusian youth obtained. Much still he talked, enraptured of the theme, though but the faint vibrations of their fame to him had echoed. Pleased his warmth to view, convinced his promise and his heart were true. The illustrious Gama thus his soul expressed, and owned the joy that labored in his breast. O thou, benign, of all the tribes alone, who feel the rigor of the burning zone, whose piety, with mercy's gentle eye, beholds our wants, and gives the wished supply. Our navy driven from many a barbarous coast, on many a tempest-harrowed ocean tossed, at last with thee a kindly refuge finds, safe from the fury of the howling winds. O generous king, may he whose mandate rolls the circling heavens, and human pride controls, may the great spirit to thy breast return, that needful aid, bestowed on us forlorn. And while yon sun emits his rays divine, and while the stars in midnight azure shine, where'er my sails are stretched the world around, thy praise shall brighten, and thy name resound. He spoke, the painted barges swept the flood, where, proudly gay, the anchored navy rode. Earnest the king the lordly fleet surveys, the mortars thunder, and the trumpets raise their martial sounds Melinda's sons to greet. Melinda's sons with timbrels hail the fleet. And now, no more the sulfury tempest roars. The boatmen leaning on the rested oars breathe short, the barges now at anchor moored. The king, while silence listened round, implored the glories of the Lusian wars to hear, whose faintest echoes long had pleased his ear. Their various triumphs on the Afric shore, o'er those who hold the son of Hagar's lore, fond he demands, and now demands again. Their various triumphs on the western main. Again, ere readiest answer found a place, he asks the story of the Lusian race. What god was founder of the mighty line? Beneath what heaven their land, what shores adjoin? And what their climate, where the sinking day gives the last glimpse of twilight's silvery ray? But most, O chief, the zealous monarch cries, what raging seas you braved, what lowering skies, what tribes, what rites you saw, what savage hate on our rude Afric proved your hapless fate. O tell, for lo, the chilly dawning star yet rides before the morning's purple car, and o'er the wave the sun's bold coursers raise their flaming fronts, and give the opening blaze. Soft on the glassy wave the zephyrs sleep, and the still billows holy silence keep. Nor less are we, undaunted chief, prepared to hear thy nation's gallant deeds declared. Nor think, though scorched beneath the car of day, our minds too dull the debt of praise to pay. Melinda's sons the test of greatness know, and on the Lusian race the palm bestow. If Titan's giant brood with impious arms shook high Olympus' brow with rude alarms, if Theseus and Pirithous dared invade the dismal horrors of the Stygian shade, nor less your glory, nor your boldness less, that thus exploring Neptune's last recess contemns his waves and tempests. If the thirst to live in fame, though famed for deeds accursed, could urge the caitiff, who to win a name gave Dion's temple to the wasting flame, if such the ardour to attain renown, how bright the lustre of the hero's crown, whose deeds of fair emprise his honours raise, and bind his brows, like thine, with deathless bays. End of the second book.